everyone. Hope you've had a good week, and looks like we have an exciting one ahead of us in the Westlife fandom. So after the exciting night that featured in last week's video, my next two Crave attempts were very disappointing. But I think it's important to know that meeting Westlife doesn't always go to plan. The second one was worse, as it was after they won Record of the Year the second time. And if you've been watching these since the start, you'll know I had a lovely meet with them after their 1999 win. Sadly, that wasn't repeated. I did see Brian and Kerry when they returned to the hotel, but they were drunk and neither of them stopped. But the rest of them didn't come back, and I sat there until 3:30 a.m. Definitely one of the most stupid things I've done, as although other fans were with me outside the hotel, I had to get home by myself. I took way too many risks when I was young. A few days later was their appearance on Pepsi Chart. This is the My Girl performance, but they also did What Makes a Man, though I don't know if it was ever shown with them missing out on number one. The most memorable thing about this was the megawatt smile Mark gave me as they passed us to get to the stage. They actually had to sing My Girl three times, as a drunk guy from the audience jumped up on the stage during one, and I can't remember what happened on the other. I'm very embarrassed by my cringeworthy attempts to do the dance moves. The next time we saw them was for the Top of the Pops performances. This time it was What Becomes of the Broken Hearted and What Makes a Man. We were front row for both, but thankfully off camera, so I didn't embarrass myself that time. Nicky and Kian kept giving us odd looks, which we put down to them vaguely remembering we were at the party, but as they were so drunk that night, they obviously weren't sure. On the 16th of December at CDUK, we put one of our brilliant plans to get ourselves noticed into action. It was around the time when Madonna had performed in tops emblazoned with Britney Spears and Kylie Minogue, and my creative friend thought it would be a great idea for us to do the same, but with the Westlife crew. She did a fantastic job of customising t-shirts that used the same typeface as Madonna had, with the names Anto, Paul, Fran, another security guard who later became Natasha Kitten's first baby daddy, Clive, their driver, and of course, not forgetting the biggest Westlife fan of all, Louis Walsh. We all wore them to see the UK and managed to get front row for Westlife's performance. The first person to notice was Brian, who laughed, nudged Shane, who actually clapped us, Nicky smiled, and eventually Mark got it too, but it took him a lot of squinting. Kian didn't seem amused, perhaps he was just having a slow day. But it was the reactions we got from Paul and Anto themselves that were really nice. Shane had alerted Paul to our search in the studio and he laughed his head off, but Anto hadn't come into the studio. So once outside and at the big high barriers behind LWT, Paul searched me out and beckoned for me to show Anto. I had my big winter coat on by then, so I essentially flashed him to show off the t-shirt. I honestly think it was one of the only times I ever saw Anto smile, as although he was never particularly nasty to the fans, you got the impression that we got in the way of the job he had to do in getting the guys to places on time. Although the lads' reactions were mainly off camera during the ad break, I still really want to find this performance of What Makes a Man from CDUK, as I only have this tiny snippet from it on another video. So if anyone has it, I'd happily pay postage for you to send me the video. We were going to GAY for the third time that night, so we bought one final man-sized t-shirt, which we decorated on my kitchen table that evening. It was the week that Bob the Builder was number one, and the Westlife single was coming out on Monday. They'd seemed concerned about this competition, which baffled us, and a few nights previously, Brian had shouted out, "Bob the Wanker!" at Top of the Pops. After talking about it for ages, we finally decided we should do a t-shirt that said this, although with part of the expletive starred out. Looking back, this was one of our greatest achievements. Although we were being completely crushed at the front at GAY, Sarah somehow managed to spread the shirt out on the stage where the guys could see it. Brian grabbed it and held it up to the audience, who were all united in booing Bob. We'd intended for him to put it on, but then he threw it back, and whoever caught it might claim it was their creation, but we know the truth. As scary as it was to be so totally crushed, it was another great performance, with Brian also putting on various hats that audience members threw to him. And when someone threw a poster up, he attached it to Shane's mic stand, as you can see here, Paul was looking on from the wings and seemed quite concerned about how crammed up against the stage we were by the rest of the crowd, bless him. The only slight disappointment I've written about is that they couldn't do the Lay My Love On You dance while singing live, and I think this photo shows them performing it sitting down, which was very odd. The next day, and thanks to my friend who could sign us in at TVC as her guests, we saw them again when they were guests on Top of the Pops Plus, which was a programme on BBC Choice. Mark said to me, "We love the t-shirts." He was talking about the crew ones from CDUK, but we also made a point of telling him the Bob one was from us. I was then a bit gutted that he got straight in the prev so I couldn't get a hug, but Sarah and I had photos with Shane instead, though I'm still not sure what he was looking at in mine, and he doesn't look too happy in hers either, probably hungover from the night before. The next day I'd woken up early as the lads were on GMTV and I wanted to watch. I was surprised when my phone started ringing at about 7:30 and it was my friend. It's in the sun and the star and the mirror. For a good 30 seconds I didn't know what she meant, and then it clicked. Her t-shirt had made the papers. It was hilarious, but as you all know, Westlife ended up losing their battle with Bob. So although we got them plenty of column inches on the day of release, I'm not sure that was a good thing. If the lads are watching, I'm sorry if I was an accessory in breaking your run of consecutive number ones, but I think Brian was mainly to blame. Unfortunately, I seem to have misplaced my press cuttings of the story, but someone typed up the Sun article. As you can see, the paper said it was Kean who held the t-shirt up, and he wasn't very happy about it in this article the following month in Smash Hits. So that was it for another mad year with the Loif. In next week's video, it's finally time for the long-awaited first arena tour. Bye for now!